Good evening. Before starting the second part of the fetal urogenital system, let's have a short recap of what we discussed in the first part. So in the first part, we discussed about the urinary tract dilatation, how to format the report of the UTD so that it will include the description of calyces, cortical thickness and echogenicity, ureter, bladder and the bladder outlet. Then we also discussed about the abnormalities of the renal number, position as well as the hyperechoic kidneys and its etiologies. So in part 2, we will discuss about the anomalies of bladder, the ambiguous genitalia, the adrenal glands and the ovarian pathologies. So bladder can be enlarged or bladder can be not at all visualized. So now coming to dilated bladder. When longitudinal diameter of the bladder is more than or equal to 7 mm in the first trimester, then it is called megacystis. No such cutoff exists in the second or the third trimester. When the bladder diameter is between 7 to 15 mm, it is mild to moderate megacystis, and in this group, 20% cases are associated with chromosomal abnormalities. While in the chromosomally normal group, more than 90% of the cases of this megacystis resolve to normal. When the bladder diameter is more than 15 mm, it is a severe form of megacystis. In this group, hardly 10% are chromosomally abnormal, but in the chromosomally normal group, the megacystis leads to progressive obstructive uropathy. So in megacystis, a chromosomal evaluation is indicated. So this is around a 13 weeks fetus where you can see a very prominent bladder. When the bladder diameter was measured, it was around 9.3 millimeters. And here you can see the kidneys, which are very prominent. The pelvic alveolar system is very prominent. The renal cortex is echogenic. And then if you see here, you can see the dilated ureter also. Well, this is another fetus of around 13 weeks where you can see this hugely dilated distended urinary bladder. See, this large bladder is seen here. The bladder can be identified by the uterine arteries. And again in this video, you can see the dilated pelvic alveolar system and then the hyperechoic renal cortex. Then what are the causes of bladder dilatation? It could be a transient dilatation or it could be an obstructive abnormality caused by posterior urethral valves or urethral stenosis or atresia or cloacal dysgenesis, or then it can be non-obstructive anomalies like the VU reflux, the vesical atonia, the megacystis microcolon intestinal hypoperistalsis, that is the MMIH syndrome, and megacystis megaureter syndrome. Both these syndromes are quite rare. Then on ultrasound, there are certain specific characteristics of the bladder along with the ureter, kidney and the amniotic fluid, which can help us to reach the specific diagnosis for the distended bladder. In posterior urethral valve, we get a distended thick walled bladder. We can get the keyhole sign. Here, the ureters are dilated. There can be hydronephrosis, and depending on the degree of hydronephrosis, the renal cortex can be echogenic, and there can be even presence of small cysts. The amniotic fluid can be normal or can be reduced. But in urethral atresia, the bladder is grossly distended with very thin walls. The kidneys are small and echogenic. They are basically because of the obstructive cystic dysplasia. And here, the liquor amount, the amniotic fluid is markedly reduced or it can be absent. While in primary reflux, the bladder wall is apparently normal. The bladder is distended. The ureters, depending on the which stage of reflux it is, it can be dilated or normal. The hydronephrosis is definitely there and the amniotic fluid is normal in primary reflux. While in cloacal dysgenesis or persistent cloaca, the distended bladder has a normal or a thick wall, and we can see the presence of hydrocolpus behind posterior to the bladder. Here, because of the compression of the bladder outlet, because of the hydrocolpus, the bladder is dilated, the ureters are dilated, we can get hydronephrosis, and depending on the degree of obstruction, the amniotic fluid may be normal or can be reduced. So here is a case of posterior urethral valve where you can see a thick walled bladder with a typical keyhole sign, and then the kidneys are highly echogenic, and you can see the central calyceal dilatation also. With recent advances, fetal intervention is possible in the luteo. So fetal interventions like the vesicoamniotic shunt, which is a percutaneously done under the ultrasound guidance, or a fetal cystoscopic laser ablation of the posterior urethral valve can be done. So now, in which fetuses should we go for the interventions? So a classification of the luteo according to the severity was proposed, in which luteo was divided into three stages. The criteria used for this staging are amniotic fluid volume, the echogenicity of the fetal kidneys, the renal cortical cyst, the renal dysplasia, and the fetal urinary biochemistry. The fetal urinary biochemistry tells us about the renal function. The renal echogenicity, the presence of the cortical cyst or the renal dysplasia indicate that the kidney is definitely damaged. So in stage 1, everything is normal. The fetal urinary biochemistry is also favorable, and therefore in such cases, the interventions are not indicated. In stage 2, there is severe luto, but the prenatal findings, the parameters like amniotic fluid, echogenicity, etc. suggest that the renal function is preserved, and in these way, if you go for fetal intervention, then there is a high chance that the severe renal impairment can be avoided. While in stage 3, the parameters already suggest that there is significant fetal abnormal renal function, and that the intervention can be indicated basically to prevent the pulmonary hypoplasia, but not the postnatal renal impairment. Now coming to the non-visualization of the bladder. Whenever the bladder is not visualized, first we have to look at the kidneys and see for the presence. If the kidneys are not present and the amniotic fluid is totally absent, then it is bilateral renal urogenesis, which can be diagnosed or confirmed on the color Doppler examination by showing the absence of the renal arteries. And then with persistently non-visualized bladder, you see kidneys, how will you proceed? So here we have to look for the echogenicities of the kidney, and then if the kidneys are hyperechoic, we need to look for the volume of the kidneys. We have studied this algorithm last time. If the volume of the kidneys is large, like the kidneys are large hyperechoic with absent or reduced amniotic fluid, then it can be ARPKD or ADPKD, or it can be bilateral multicystic kidney. And then if the renal volume is reduced with decreased amniotic fluid, then it is Potter type 4 type, means it is the obstructive cystic renal dysplasia. Now, if the kidney echogenicity is normal, how will we proceed? There, we have to look at the amniotic fluid. If the amniotic fluid is reduced with the absent or reversed end diastolic flow on in the umbilical arteries, then it is a severe FGR. And if the amniotic fluid is normal, we have to evaluate the genital area to look for any genital mass which can represent a bladder extrophy or a cloacal extrophy. The rare causes of bladder non-visualization which we should know are bladder extrophy and the cloacal extrophy. Bladder extrophy is a very rare condition which occurs in 1 in 30,000 live births. Here there is persistently non-visualization of the bladder with a small mass on the lower anterior abdominal wall. It is associated with abnormal genitalia and the amniotic fluid is normal. To differentiate the bladder extrophy from other anterior abdominal masses, the K angle was proposed by Kavita Aneja in IJRI in 2017. So what is this K angle? It is the angle between the umbilical arteries and the aorta. Normally this angle is an acute angle, while in bladder extrophy, this angle becomes an obtuse, or it goes nearly to 90 degrees. These images are from Dr. Aneja's publication, where in the lower one you can see the acute angle formed by the umbilical arteries and the aorta junction, while in bladder extrophy here you can see that the angle has become obtuse. In the axial section we can see the parallel course of the intra-abdominal umbilical arteries instead of the converging course. Cloacal extrophy, it's a still rare condition. Here persistent cloaca occurs because of failure of the urorectal septum to divide cloaca into anterior urinary bladder and the posterior rectum. In presence of a lower anterior abdominal wall defect, this persistent cloacal eversion occurs, leading to the cloacal extrophy. Here again on ultrasound, we cannot see the bladder. There is an infra-umbilical mass which is formed by the everted cloaca and also the omphalocele. Spinal, renal and lower limb anomalies are associated with cloacal extrophy. And this is a postnatal picture of a typical elephant trunk appearance in the cloacal extrophy, where we can see the omphalocele. The bilateral bulges are the hemibladders, and through which a small bowel herniation occurs, which give an appearance of the elephant trunk. So this is the elephant trunk appearance classical of cloacal extrophy. Now coming to ambiguous genitalia, the incidence is around 1 in 4,500. On ultrasound, the accurate diagnosis is very difficult. The micropenis with cryptorchidism cannot always be differentiated on ultrasound from the clitoral hypertrophy with normal labia. So here is a case. This primie came for ultrasound between 17 to 18 weeks. The ultrasound findings were that there were bilateral CTV, adrenal glands were enlarged, and the genitalia were abnormal. So here in this clip, you can see hypoechoic triangular large areas just above the kidneys. The length of this hypoechoic triangular area is nearly half that of the kidneys. So these are the still images of the left adrenal and the right adrenal gland, which are enlarged. And on this clip of the perineal area, you can see the labia, and in between there is a protrusion. So in this case, diagnosis of congenital adrenal hyperplasia was suspected. The patient refused any fetal investigations like amnio, and the pregnancy was terminated. And this is the picture of the abortus showing the abnormal genitalia. And this is the report of the mother, which was later done, where it shows that the CYP21A2 gene shows a mutation which is associated with congenital adrenal hyperplasia, though in this case it was of uncertain clinical significance. The other adrenal gland anomalies which we can see in the prenatal period are the adrenal gland cysts, where we can see just above the kidney, we can see rounded lesions which may be anechoic or can have internal echoes. There can be adrenal hemorrhage which present as mass, and then there can be neuroblastoma, which are very rare finding. And ovarian cysts are the common intraabdominal cysts in the female fetus, and they are usually seen in the third trimester. Presentation is usually an anechoic cyst in the pelvis. At times the cyst can be hemorrhagic and may go in torsion. It can be a unilocular or it can be a multilocular cyst. Rarely there can be polyhydramnios because of bowel obstruction caused by the large cyst. And spontaneous regression is always seen after the birth. On ultrasound, we need to show the cyst separate from the bladder. The identification of the bladder can be done by the visualization of the umbilical arteries on the color Doppler. And in our reporting, we should mention about the presence of pelvic cyst rather than labeling them as ovarian cyst in the report. So to conclude, bladder must be documented in all trimester. A detailed evaluation of the perineal area is indicated in suspected pathologies. And to repeat again, a GOT evaluation begins from the first trimester, and we should remember that the CACUT, that is the congenital anomalies of kidney and the urinary tract, are evolving anomalies. And in the description of the urinary tract dilatation, we should include the renal pelvis, calyces, ureter and the bladder, as well as the amniotic fluid. And then we should remember that ultrasound finding can prognosticate the renal outcome, and therefore they should be very meticulously evaluated. And a timely antenatal and the postnatal therapy can be initiated by our prenatal ultrasound findings, which prevent the renal damage and improves the outcome of the affected child. Thank you very much.